Thank you very much, Luca. Thank you, Giovanna, for inviting me to this event to commemorate Marco Vergelli, a former postdoc of mine, and to go together with you over some findings that he generated while in the laboratory, and also give you some general thoughts about how his work contributed to our understanding the background of multiple sclerosis, and also, in general, the role of T cells for autoimmunity. So the parts, I would like to briefly say a few words about Marco, then about the background of multiple sclerosis. I don't have to say too much. You have already heard this from Luca, very well introduced before. Also a few general words about autoreactive T cells that we think are important in many autoimmune diseases, and then focus more on the questions that Marco's work addressed in a very short period of time, only in 3 years, while at NIH, even though he was already well trained when he came, and the impact it had on further studies and for the field. So, as I mentioned, Marco came from here, from Florence, and I have to say at NIH in a very rich, in many aspects, research environment. One big advantage was that well-trained people from outside, like Marco, came there, even usually with their own money. This was a tremendous resource, which is very difficult to underestimate or you only value once you leave NIH. So Marco came from here, from Florence. He was had trained with Luca Masacesi before in the entire environment around Luigi Amaducci and Riccardo Saccardi. He was in contact with immunologists here in Florence that he learned from. And when he came to the neuroimmunology branch, recruited by Henry McFarland, my mentor, he stayed there for 3 years, from 1994 to 1997. Let me briefly mention a few people who worked with Marco at NIH. Henry, my former mentor, that Bernhard Hemmer, who is now in Munich. Marco worked very closely with him. Paolo Muraro is now in London at Imperial College. Then Bruno Gran, who also came from Florence and from Luca's group, who is now in Nottingham in England. Benedetta Mazzanti, who was briefly at NIH, is now back in Florence here and works with Riccardo Saccardi, and then also scientists at Eric Long's lab at the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Disease, and also people from Ron Germain's lab. And I have to say, this was a very stimulating time. It's difficult to convey this today, and maybe this is equally stimulating right now, but at NIH, embedded in an environment where many scientists around you do interesting work, at this time when it was declared that one wanted to sequence the entire human genome. This was happening during that time. So not only in our little lab, but also in general, this was really a very exciting time. And just show you also some of the faces. Here you see Marco. In this case here together with Francesco Lolli, who came to visit, who's also from Florence here in front of one of his posters, and here with Bernhard Hemmer and Paolo Muraro that I just mentioned. A few words on the context that, in addition to what Luca already presented, shall give you some insight on why we think CD4 T lymphocytes are important. So in MS, like in many other autoimmune diseases that have a complex genetic background, we believe that certain molecules, MHC or HLA molecules, and in this case, particularly these two alleles here, are important. They confer about 50% of the genetic risk of the disease, and then there are 100 or more genes that convey much or confer much less risk. Then there are environmental factors, for example, Epstein-Barr virus, low vitamin D levels, smoking, and others that are also predisposing etiologically to the disease. And then obviously these two lead to a very complex interplay and influence our immune system and how it responds to various stimuli. Let me briefly go over the evidence why we today think that, like in rheumatoid arthritis, like in autoimmune diabetes, that CD4 lymphocytes are very important. For many decades now, there's an animal model in which it has been shown that you can take pieces of the myelin that you saw before, You can ground them up and inject an animal that is susceptible for a CNS autoimmune disease like MS, and this animal will get sick. And then you can take T lymphocytes, primarily CD4 lymphocytes, from that animal and transfer them to a healthy animal and induce the disease again, which showed that the disease, or most of it, can be transferred by a single cell population that was originally induced by these myelin antigens. I already mentioned the important role of HLA class 2. HLA class 2 molecules are the recognition structures that CD4 T lymphocytes use to recognize peptide antigens that are embedded here in the peptide binding groove of the HLA molecule and recognized by a CD4 T cell by its receptor. CD4 T cells are found in the cerebrospinal fluid, but also in the brain of MS patients, among other cells, so they're not the only ones, and maybe others are even more important at the effector stage of the disease. And in genetically identical twins, it has been shown that if you look at the T cell receptor repertoire of CD4 cells, in identical twins, where one individual is sick and the other individual is healthy, that there are differences, supporting that these cells, again, even in identical twins, are involved. And then some other data I will show you. So the working scenario that we currently have, how we believe an autoimmune disease starts, is that in the presence of certain risk genes, like the HLA-DR15 molecule, a repertoire of T cells is selected in our body that has the potential to mount an immune response against autoantigens, in the case of MS, against nervous system antigens. And then an environmental trigger, a virus, for example, or a bacterial antigen, stimulates some of these cells that are potentially autoreactive out of this repertoire. These cells expand and may attack myelin and lead to what you have heard before, inflammation in the brain, demyelination, and axon loss, so the disease MS. I don't want to go over this complicated slide. All I want to show you that we currently believe that this initial step here, the activation of potentially autoreactive T cells, their expansion and their maintenance, and finally migration into the nervous system and damaging all the cells there, and mounting an inflammatory response in the brain, so that this piece down here, this part of the whole slide, is tremendously important for inducing and perpetuating the disease. And that's really what Marco's work was about. When Marco came to NIH, a number of groups had already generated some data that is tried to summarize here. So what I'm showing you here is one myelin antigen, myelin basic protein, that is part of the compact myelin wrapped around an axon here. And this 170 amino acid long protein was shown to harbor many peptides that, when you inject them into monkeys, rhesus monkeys, into SJL mice, other mice, PL mice or BLK6 mice, or Lewy rats, or other rat strains or guinea pigs, that certain areas of this protein can mount an MS-like disease in animals called EAE. And when we and others mapped the immunodominant regions of human MBP in the human T-cell immune system in healthy controls in MS patients, the very same areas are immunodominant for the CD4 T-cell response in humans. And I would like to highlight this area here in the middle of the protein that is encephalogenic in several animal strains and immunodominant in humans, because a lot of the things that I'm going to present you will be about this protein. So which questions and parts did Marco's work mainly address? One was the fine specificity of autoreactive T cells, focusing on this peptide, but also others. The importance how environmental triggers via molecular mimicry, by similarities, which I'm going to show you, may induce a disease, and then also some other topics. So let me first come to a very puzzling question. A few years ago, a group in Paris around Professor Kurilski at the Pasteur Institute could show that among the theoretical number of T cells, which is very large, and in our body we have about 10 to the 11 to 10 to the 13 lymphocytes in the bloodstream or in the liver and other organs. When you look at the number of T cell receptors, this structure here, there's only 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 7 different T cell receptors. This sounds still like a big number. But when you consider that a T lymphocyte recognizes peptides, that are among 10 to 25 amino acids long, the number of possibilities that these peptides can represent is between 20 to the 10th and 20 to the 25th, a number that is much, much larger than the number of different T-cell receptors that we have. What that means is an important question arises: how do such a limited number of T-cells protect us against all the potential numbers of antigens? And the way this could happen is covered by a theoretical framework that was established first by Fujinami and Ohlstone with this science paper here many years ago. And what they could show is that molecular mimicry between a foreign, for example, viral antigen, and between a self protein can exist. And what this group showed in this science article in 1985 is that hepatitis B virus polymerase and myelin basic protein harbor a 6-mer peptide, and that this 6-mer peptide can be cross-recognized and lead to an MS-like disease, in this case in rabbits. Now, the problem is here you request in the molecular mimicry scheme at that time that a peptide needs to be identical between the foreign agent, the virus or bacterium, and the self protein, in this case MBP. And if already 10 years later, Kai Bucherpfennig and Jack Strominger could show that when a T-cell recognizes a peptide, that certain residues are more important than others. This was the belief at that time, that certain residues of the peptide contact the T-cell receptor to the above, and certain amino acids are particularly important for embedding the peptide in the HLA molecule. And using this knowledge, they used a bioinformatics strategy to look for preservation of certain motifs, here shown in blue and in red, between autoantigens and, in this case, a terminase protein from herpes simplex virus. And what Kai Bucherpfennig could show is that as long as these motifs are preserved, that individual T-cell clones that are specific for MBP 86 to 97 in this case can be stimulated by viral peptides that just share this motif. And what you can deduce from this is already that a much larger number, that only identical peptides are recognized if only similarity of this motif is requested. And now let me come to some work of Marco. At the time when he was at our laboratory, we started again with T-cell clones specific for this very same peptide that Kai Bucherpfennig used, the middle MBP peptide that I showed you before, and determined which amino acids are important for pointing to the T-cell receptor and which ones are important for binding to the HLA. And then we mutated single amino acids and could show that by single amino acid substitutions, for example, here a threonine to an alanine, you can shift the dose response curve to the left, meaning that the T-cell clone responds better to a variant peptide that has a substituted amino acid. And here it's shown for a number of other substitutions. What that means is that probably T-cell recognition by the T-cell receptor is more degenerate or more flexible than previously thought and anticipated. And that there are even amino acid substitutions that not only worsen recognition but also improve it. And this was systematically then studied, and one conclusion from this work is summarized here, that these results suggest that similar to what has been described for peptide HLA interactions, that each amino acid in the peptide sequence contributes independently to T-cell receptor recognition, and that the outcome of TCR ligation, this is from a paper of Marco, by a given HLA peptide complex is the integration of the effects, and this is tried to be summarized down here, of each amino acid either contacting the HLA or the TCR or contributing actually to recognition and interaction to both.